the governor of Lagos State. Welcome back. Welcome, Governor Fashola. Thank you very much for coming back on the program with me.
It's always good to talk to you.
Right. I thought we'll start with your government's containment of the Ebola virus disease. I know that on September 18, 2014, you were able to declare Lagos State as Ebola free. Having been caught unawares by that, do we now have a permanent quarantine center in Lagos just in case we have another infectious disease problem?
I know that this is a 60-minute program, yes. And I don't want this discussion itself to narrow around Ebola.
Okay.
I think there's a larger issue here.
Right.
Infectious diseases. And they have been around for as long as the human civilization has been. From the bubonic plague, the Black Death, cholera, SARS in modern times, foot and mouth disease, H1N1, D68, new viruses will emerge, HIV, AIDS,
yes,
and all of that. So I want us to see the larger picture. Ebola is just one of them. There's been Lassa fever.
There's dengue fever.
There's dengue fever. Ebola and Lassa fever fall in the category of hemorrhagic fevers. And so it's to realize that the world has had to deal with infectious diseases that have reached epidemic proportions, and that there will be other infectious diseases across the world.
Yes.
The viruses that will originate and need to be studied and understood in order to enable scientists to go back to work and do new things,
yes,
in order to protect all of us.
Yes.
Now, to the extent that we now have an increasingly borderless world, just imagine you buying something online,
yes,
in a box,
yes,
across jurisdictions, across the seas. It can be shipped with anything and boom. So, first of all, we must understand that we must thank all of those from generation to generation who have evolved the various vaccinations that help to immunize us,
yes,
against diseases like measles, cholera, diphtheria, whooping cough. At some point in time in human civilization, there was no answer for them. We must also be thankful to scientists who have helped to produce drugs that have helped us to cure those diseases. Now, you will see that there are two distinct ends here.
Yes.
A drug as a cure.
Yes.
A vaccine as immunization. And so I go back to the word that you raised about quarantine, because,
yes,
there was a lot of terminologies used out there,
yes,
that I think we didn't dwell on enough, and that must be a communication responsibility that we owe. There was quarantine, there was isolation, there was tracking,
yes,
and all of that.
Yes.
Now back to Ebola. What did we do? We brought in people who were ill with symptoms of the virus.
Yes.
Fever, usually. Some had reached vomiting stage. And we now started tracking all those who had contacted them.
Yes.
Or who we suspected could have been contacts. Family, people who tried to heal them, and all of that. Now, you don't bring people who are not confirmed as Ebola cases,
yes,
into the infectious disease hospital, because that is the making of an epidemic. So what we did was,
yes,
that we got the names of all of the contacts, and we were talking to them on a daily basis. We got thermometers to them, take your temperature at least twice a day, record the readings, and let us know.
Okay.
Tell us what new symptoms, if any, you are manifesting. If we saw temperature rising consistently, then we moved in with doctors,
right,
who would evaluate the situation and say, no, stay at home.
Okay.
This is not, you are not at risk. And remember that you can't transmit unless you begin to show
symptoms
and you fall sick.
Right. So you can be carrying the symptoms.
Precisely the point.
And you are not yet sick.
Precisely
you
the point.
You can't transfer it.
You can't transfer it. Now, so if another symptom then manifested, then we brought them in, took samples, blood, and sent it to the lab. At that time, they are now moved to quarantine. That is different from the isolation ward, where confined, sick, and those in need of care were. So it is in the isolation ward that you need the protective equipment. Right. So it's a part of a complex. So in the quarantine, you don't need the PPE.
Right.
Of course, it will be sensible to wear gloves, wear face masks, like in any hospital, until you know what you are dealing with, and then you move. So I think these were things, but we were too busy trying to contain, and so that information didn't come out. So people were in the hospitals, in the infectious disease center.
Yes.
And we must remember this. Lagos had had that infectious disease hospital to treat tuberculosis and all those kind of infections. Okay. So that was what we converted when this happened. Going forward, the plan is to rebuild the entire place into a medical research center for infectious disease, build a much more modern isolation unit now with much more equipment and so many things. So the Commissioner for Health will be making all of the announcements that we have approved of policies, plans and programs beyond this. Make no mistake about it, as long as other African countries,
yes,
and indeed European and American countries remain infected,
yes,
we remain at risk. No doubt about that.
So even
what is important,
yes,
is that the lessons that we have learned, continuous hygiene, stop urinating in public, stop defecating in public, constantly wash your hands with soap and water,
yes,
must remain with us long after Ebola. There's a training program that we're organizing for all hospitals, private hospitals, because a lot of tropical diseases present first as fever.
Fever, malaria, typhoid.
So that training program, the Commissioner for Health will be announcing that in the next few days, weeks, and how that goes to improve knowledge and capacity and training. Beyond this, we already have, I think, about 28 people who have agreed to volunteer,
yes,
our health workers, who we're sending to Sierra Leone, because that is the last and first line of defense. If we can help Sierra Leone overcome the way America is helping Liberia, then we can lie at ease. For now, we can't. And as I said, it's not always so much about money as indeed it is about personnel, knowledgeable personnel. What was instructive in the Lagos experience was that all the health workers that we deployed to look after people, none of them got infected, unlike what has happened in America, unlike what has happened in other jurisdictions. So that for us means that there is a body of knowledge and experience here that we can ship out.
Yes.
And we've done this before as a country, helping those two countries during the Ecomog fleet and all of that. And this is the kind of leadership that I think Nigeria should be showing at a continental and regional level. I understand that people understandably were afraid, but the knowledge that has been gathered over 40 years,
yes,
now has helped us in a lot of ways to respond to our own case. Now, that knowledge, of course, was always what happened in rural areas. And from some of the things I read, in many of the rural areas there, children had gotten to understand that, oh, that disease has come.
Yes.
So they just stay away from mother or father who has it,
yes,
until they die. Just don't touch. So they were in different parts of the same room for days,
yes,
until the
person died,
and they just moved out and left everything behind, and in some instances just burnt them. But they were in rural areas. So Lagos was the first urban experience globally of Ebola. Now, so what we're doing is to document everything that has taken place here during that period, what we did, every process,
yes,
so that we can share it with the world. Because that is the only way we can contribute to knowledge about the disease in a way that will help researchers understand it better and probably develop either a drug or a vaccine. And it's knowledge, more knowledge, that helps the researchers understand that, okay, this is how it behaves.
Yes.
It is that body of knowledge that has been gathered over 40 years that makes everybody now know that if you survive it after 21 days, it's over. It's from there they knew that, okay, first presents as a fever. It's from there that they knew that, okay, you start bleeding and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And it's from there they knew that even the dead body is more dangerous
than the living.
Now, some more information will come out in terms of the protocols for management,
the protocols for wearing your safety equipment going forward. You see that those protocols are already being revised by the CDC in America. So all of the material, thankfully, Dr. Idris was in the U.S. going to share because they invited me, but I thought it was appropriate for him to go.
The Commissioner for Health.
So he was there sharing with the members of the Congressional Black Caucus, I think, who invited us. And they were discussing not just Ebola, really, the challenges of globalization and urbanization, and this is only one of them.
So when the WHO, World Health Organization, says they will declare us Ebola-free on October 20, because we still have it in some countries in West Africa, we really cannot, put our guards down.
You see, the 21-day cycle post the last case is what WHO is just counting, just to be doubly sure. Because, as I said, the risk of reinfection is always there. So instead of being sorry, be safe. So we waited for 121 days. They're waiting for the second 21 days. And that is one of the terms that has come up during the process, the decontamination. So, for example, the center has been decontaminated once. They're going to decontaminate it the second time. They're going to do it the third time. So that normal activity can return First consultant, the hospital was decontaminated thrice. So contrary to what people were thinking, that they didn't want to open the hospital, they shut it down. No, we were making it safe.
So it is safe now.
It is safe.
People.
It's back to business. It's like your lipstick. Instead of using one coat, use two or three. Just to be sure that it stays.
It doesn't go
It doesn't
away.
Come off.